Good morning, and a very warm welcome to you as we gather together for our worship this morning. As we begin our worship, we're going to sing together what we might call a statement of faith. So I hope you will join along as we sing together, "I believe in Jesus, I believe He is the Son of God." And so we turn to our Lord in prayer. Let us pray. And so, Lord, as we gather for worship, we proclaim you as our God. We proclaim you as our Lord, as our Saviour. And as we sang in that song, Lord, we're reminded again that no matter where we are, you are present with us in this very moment. We don't need to go looking for you. We don't need to go to church to find you. Lord, you are wherever we are. And so as we worship together, although we might be separated, you, Lord, are present. As we find ourselves in the middle of Lent, preparing for Easter, Lord, we're reminded of all that leads us towards that point. That in your love and your grace, you chose to send your Son. And in his mercy and grace and love, he chose to die upon the cross. And so, Lord, we come together with a purpose. We come together with the intention of worshiping you, of lifting your name on high, of being reminded again of the God that you are. And so, Lord, in our worship, We know too, we come, Lord, as tainted people, imperfect souls. And so we would ask, Lord, for you to forgive us for all our sins. Forgive us for those things that have got in the way of relationships with others and with you. Forgive us, Lord, when we've got caught up in self, our own pride, ambition, our own perspectives, and in those moments have ignored you or been so distracted, Lord, we've forgotten about you. Forgive us, Lord, for all our sins. Set us free from that guilt. Release us again, Lord, in this moment, that as we worship you, we would know deep in our hearts and souls that we are at one with you. So, Lord, may your mercy, your love, your grace flow through our hearts and our lives as we are reminded of your grace and as we receive your forgiveness. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the gift of this moment. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, for all that you have in store for us as we share in this format, as we share in our lives beyond this moment. We give you thanks, Lord, for all that you've done for us. And so bless us through your Spirit as we worship together, as we read your word, as we respond to that. So, Lord, speak to us, our hearts and our minds. And may we, through your Spirit, have the courage to respond to your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What makes a special moment special? What makes something really special? Is it something that's out of the ordinary? Is it a moment that is quite unique, significant, maybe even symbolical? Can you think of a moment like that in your life? It could be as simple as moving into a new home. It's a moment where there's a change, where we start something new. We don't do that every day, so it makes it quite unique. It's significant because in those moments we then have a shelter, a place that we can call home. And maybe it's symbolical of independence, of moving up, of being able to do something differently. It could even be an achievement, a task well done that we celebrate. We did it well, it's over, we've completed our task, and so we celebrate with a meal. There are many moments that are special moments. Birthdays, anniversaries, weddings, graduation, end of school term, beginning of a new job, retirement. And so we could go on and on and on. But whenever we have a special moment that's special to us, we often end up celebrating those moments. I invite you to listen to scripture as we read about two very special moments that come to us into today's reading. I first read from 1 Samuel chapter 9 verses 27 to chapter 10 verse 1. Hear these words of scripture as we share together. When they arrived at the edge of town, Samuel said to Saul, "Tell the servant to go on ahead of us." The servant left and Samuel continued, "Stay here a moment. I will tell you what God has said." Then Samuel took a jar of olive oil and poured it on Saul's head, kissed him and said, "The Lord anoints you as ruler of his people Israel. You will rule his people and protect them from all their enemies. And this is the proof that the Lord has chosen you to be the ruler of his people." Our second passage comes from the Gospels, from John's Gospel, chapter 12, verses 1 to 8. Jesus is anointed at Bethany. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus went to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, the man he had raised from death. They prepared a dinner for him there, which Martha helped serve. Lazarus was one of those who was sitting at the table with Jesus. Then Mary took a whole pint of a very expensive perfume made of pure nard, poured it on Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The sweet smell of the perfume filled the whole house. One of Jesus' disciples, Judas Iscariot, the one who was going to betray him, said, "Why wasn't this perfume sold for 300 silver coins and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He carried the money bag and would help himself from it. But Jesus said, "Leave her alone. Let her keep what she has for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor people with you, but you will not always have me." May God bless his reading to us. Amen. Two very special moments. Saul is anointed by Samuel, a unique moment, the inauguration of a king, which doesn't happen every day, a significant moment, because God has chosen Saul to be king of his people, a symbolical moment, as his head is anointed with olive oil. His head anointed as head of the nation, and he will lead the nation and protect them from their enemies. Jesus is anointed by Mary, a unique moment. The acknowledgement of Jesus being Master and Lord, happening at a dinner around a table, but a unique moment because of the actions of Mary, a significant moment, as this is the preparation for Christ's death on the cross. This is the week leading up to his crucifixion, a symbolical moment, as Jesus' feet are anointed to serve, not the head, but the feet, to serve all people as Savior of the world. Anointing means to be set apart with a task to do. Saul is set apart to be king and to lead the nation and protect them. Jesus is set apart to be the Savior of the world. Two very special moments. But we too are anointed. Maybe not with oil and with perfume, but we are anointed with the Holy Spirit. We're anointed as the children of God. As Romans chapter 8 verse 16 says, God's Spirit joins himself to our spirits to declare that we are God's children. We're anointed into the family of God. A unique moment as God chooses us, each and every one of us, adopted into Christ's family. God chose you. A significant moment, because no one is excluded. In a sense, we're all available. We're all chosen. We're all anointed. The moment we turn to Christ, the moment we receive him as Lord and Savior, it is a significant moment. Every single one of us matter. Our actions matter. Our lives matter. We are significant in the kingdom of God. Symbolical. Our anointing is an anointing of the heart. Not the head, not the feet, but an anointing of the heart. That we are in relationship with God. And we're in relationship with others. And we're anointed set apart, just like Saul and Jesus. Except our setting apart is that we belong to God. We're set apart from the world. We're different from the world in which we live. We serve a different kingdom. We are the salt of the earth. We live within the world, but we are of a different kingdom. We're set apart from the world, all of us with a task to do. And that is special. That is worth celebrating. And each time we come into worship, each time we interact with Jesus, each time that we have an encounter of faith is a special moment. Maybe we've got so used to worshiping that we don't see worship as a special moment. But it is, it's a special moment, a moment to celebrate, a moment to be reminded of who God is and what God has done for us. We share a special life, a life with the Christ. We are anointed. But often this is where things come off the rails. Because often, not always, but often, we ignore our anointing. People don't see Christianity as relevant or effective or maybe even as making a difference because they don't see Christ in us. They don't see Christ impacting the world because they don't see it happening in each of us. Yet we're anointed. The problem is we often fail to take our anointing out into the world. Somehow we keep our anointing as being unique, significant, and symbolical of being part of God's kingdom, but we don't take it out into our everyday worlds. Somewhere between church and the world, our anointing gets lost. Christ gets lost. We ignore our anointing. People don't see our faith in us. We get sucked into what's happening in the world and we forget to be the people set apart. We forget to be the people anointed by Christ, by the Holy Spirit. People don't see our Christianity as relevant and as effective because we don't live out our faith in meaningful, expressible ways within the world. Often people leave Jesus in the church. Yet it's outside the church where Christ needs to be seen. Often people leave Christ in the church. But it's outside the church that people are craving all that Christ offers. And we don't take it out there. We leave Jesus in the church. Often we ignore our anointing and the world's craving for Jesus will never be satisfied if we don't carry Jesus out into the world. Mark chapter 1 verse 29 gives us a good example. The disciples come to Jesus. Jesus has been teaching and healing people and they come to Jesus and they say, "Everyone is looking for you." And Jesus responds, "We must go on to the other villages around here. We do not just keep it here. We need to move out there. We don't keep Christ to ourselves. We need to share Christ with others. We need to ensure that we take Jesus into the world, so that others may understand and experience Jesus as relevant, as effective, as real, as special, as unique. It's been said, there is no substitute for outstretched hands and outstretched lives. No committees, no organizational structures, no situation, no clubs can ever offer a personal touch, a relationship. We need to stretch out our lives, ourselves, and our hands, and we need to get personally involved in allowing Jesus to be seen in our outside worlds. The only way that's going to happen is if we do what Jesus did. Move out. Move into the world. We need to become more mission-minded. We need to practice our anointing. Set apart as a child of God, for God, in the world. We need to be reaching out to others. Jesus was always involved with other people. We need to have a passion and an action to share Jesus with others. We need to be personally involved as we have time and give time to being relevant as people of faith, as Christians in our everyday world. Anointed as God's children, we are set apart with a task to move out and to show others a relevant and effective and a real Jesus. There's a story from the States of a place called St. Paul in Minnesota, where a number of years ago there was a magnificent Lutheran church. On one tragic day, it was burned to the ground in a tragic fire. In the church, there was a replica of the Walsen's famous statue of the appearing Christ. The original is in Copenhagen Lutheran Cathedral, and it depicts Christ with his arms outstretched, but also his head bowed. And beneath this particular statue is the words, "Come unto me, all ye who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." The interesting thing about the statue and the way that it was created was you almost need to kneel in front of the statue and look up to look into the eyes of Christ. The amazing thing that happened in Minnesota was, as much as the church was burnt to the ground, the statue was completely untouched. It stood tall amidst all the charred ruins of the church. People going to work saw the church, saw the statue for the first time because they'd never known it was there. And people would climb over the charred remains of the building just to go and look into the eyes of Jesus. Thousands of people discovered the appeal of Christ, for he was no longer contained within the walls of a church building. We need to ensure that the specialness of our anointing that keeps bringing us back to church week after week gets taken out into the world. I'll say that again. The specialness of our anointing that keeps bringing us back to church week after week needs to get out into our world. Others need to begin to see it and experience it. Others need to begin to understand our faith, realize that it's real, know that it's real by the way we live, by the way we take Christ out into the world. So let me ask you this. How are you going to enable the specialness of Jesus to be seen in your everyday world? How are you going to enable the specialness of Jesus to be seen in your everyday world? We sing together, "Make me a channel of your peace."
Make me a channel of your peace. Lord, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. Where there's doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Must have grown that I may never see. So much to be consoled as to console. To be understood as to understand. To be loved as to love.
And so we turn to our Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father God, we pray that you would make us channels of your peace, that we would bring the specialness of Jesus into our everyday world, that, Lord, people would know your love, that when we bring healing to those who are injured, pardon to those who feel burdened, we would pray, Lord, that we would bring hope to those who are in despair, that through our lives, Lord, we would bring light to those in darkness. So we pray, Lord, we would not ignore our anointing, but we would celebrate the specialness of Jesus in our everyday worlds. May we seek, Lord, to save souls, to remind others of who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so we conclude our time together as we sing our final song, and I want to highlight the third verse for you. Spirit of our God descending, fill our hearts with heavenly joy, love with every passion blending, pleasure that can never cloy, thus provided, pardoned, guided, nothing can our peace destroy. We sing together. And I invite you to receive this blessing as we go our separate ways. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.